It's a legendary comic book tale. The teenage whiz kid, Peter Parker, is bitten by a radioactive spider and he turns into a beloved superhero, Spider-Man. But last fall, when the musical version of Spider-Man previewed on Broadway, it was plagued with problems. Performers were seriously injured. Reviews were dreadful.
Broadway's Spider-Man, Turn Off the Dark, has been making unwelcome headlines for months. Opening day for this $65 million musical keeps getting postponed, and the technical problems and negative reviews aren't helping.
Whose idea was it to make Spider-Man into a musical?
With great power comes no profitability. This one phrase can sum up the wild roller coaster ride that went behind the most expensive and dangerous musical to ever hit Broadway. With over 27 aerial sequences, over 6 cast injuries, a staggering budget of $79 million, and a revolving door of actors, producers, directors, and writers, this was the musical where the behind-the-scenes drama was more exciting than what was going on stage. And which played a role in its success and its inevitable downfall. This is the story of a producer in over his head, a director with too much creative freedom, and a further lesson for why I hate Bono. But in total, this is a story of hubris, a story of betrayal, and a story of blind optimism that led them off of the Brooklyn Bridge. This is the story of what went wrong with Spider-Man. Turn Off the Dark. Superhero movies are everywhere you look. As soon as one comes out, another one is right around the corner. In 2019 alone, there are going to be 10 superhero movies released, ranging from Avengers Endgame, Shazam, Captain Marvel, Hellboy, Dark Phoenix, and Spider-Man Far From Home, to name a few. It's easy to forget, with the frequency that these films are coming out now, that superhero movies weren't always as sure a bet as they are today. Specifically, looking back to 1997, and the release of Bat Nipples and Robin, the biggest budget toy commercial to ever be released. The dark backstory that had been carefully crafted in Tim Burton's 1989 Batman reboot had been abandoned for campy characters, ice puns, and a bat credit card. The film was so bad that it effectively killed the Batman franchise for nearly 10 years. People couldn't believe in the superhero film anymore, and were instead drawn to actions and thrillers, specifically with the releases of films such as Gladiator and Memento. It wasn't until 2002 that the superhero and film industry was flipped on its head. Now, there were standout superhero movies that rocked pop culture before, especially with Richard Donner's Superman and the previously mentioned Tim Burton Batman film. But one superhero who hadn't been able to find his footing in the film world was the friendly neighborhood wall crawler Spider-Man. He had a few films, starting back with an unauthorized short film in 1969 and a made-for-TV film on CBS in 1977, as well as the absolutely fantastic Japanese Spider-Man, which came with its very own Transformer Power Ranger suit. But it wasn't until Sony Productions Entertainment came into possession of the rights that Spider-Man would find himself in the same echelon of Donner's Superman and Burton's Batman. In 2002, the first Spider-Man film starring Tobey Maguire and directed by Sam Raimi hit theaters and shattered box office records, becoming the first film to pass $100 million in a single weekend and establishing a new opening weekend record. Spider-Man became a cultural hit and slowly started to become everyone's superhero, myself included in that count. He was everywhere, on t-shirts, in action figures, and can anyone forget the feeling of amazement when they first laid eyes on the Spider-Man glove which shot out silly string? I remember when I got one and I legit thought it was like the movie, and only found out otherwise after crashing onto the patio boards after trying to shoot a web and latch onto a beam from jumping off of a chair. But the point still stands that Spider-Man was a hit, and so of course Marvel wanted to capitalize on it. In August of 2002, only 3 months after the release of the film, Tony Adams, a prominent film and stage producer best known for his work on the Pink Panther films, was approached to produce a stage musical based on the comics of America's new favorite superhero. Tony was ecstatic and ready to begin the process with his protege, David Garfinkel, a 49-year-old entertainment lawyer who always wanted to be a Broadway producer. He didn't have many credits or much experience, but he was excited to serve as a shadow, learning from a revered producer in Adams. Then came the assembling of what seemed to be a Broadway dream team. It all started with an interview with Andrew Lloyd Webber, who is quoted in the New York Post as saying, "I'd like to thank rock musicians for leaving me alone for 25 years. I've had the theater all to myself." Somewhere in the world, Bono's spiteful senses started tingling, and upon being approached, he figured that this musical would be a great way for him and The Edge to give Webber a run for his money, with one condition. They had to bring on board Julie Taymor to direct. Taymor seemed like a safe bet, with her Broadway production of The Lion King earning $3.6 billion globally, and her artistic prowess and ingenuity being applauded by critics and audience members alike. Taymor agreed to jump on board, and would play a big role in writing the script alongside Glenn Berger. Everything was coming together better than according to plan, and it seemed like nothing could stop the eventual smash hit that this show was destined to become. Fast forward to October 2005. The finalized creative team assembled together for the first time at The Edge's apartment. There was a feeling of excitement in the air as the contracts were about to be officially signed. After looking the contracts over, the only thing left to do was to sign them, but The Edge realized that they didn't have a pen. He briefly excused himself from the room, grabbed a pen, and when he came back to the room, Tony Adams, the producer, was on the floor, unresponsive. After being taken to a hospital, he was declared DOA. The contracts had not been signed, the process had not even begun yet, and already, the lead producer had died of a stroke. This left David Garfinkel, a man whose closest experience with Broadway had come from defending entertainment cases, and whom had never tackled a project of this size, as the lead producer for the show. Garfinkel wasn't stupid, though. He knew that he lacked the creative prowess to make the show what it needed to be, and in turn, ceded all artistic direction and decisions to Taymor. After holding the first readings in 2007, the initial budget for the show was set at a record-setting $52 million, a number that would soon come to look like a dust speck on how much the show would actually cost. The script was physically insane, with stage directions and cues that would require intense design and tech elements that had not been seen in a Broadway theater. This was part of the reason that superhero shows weren't typically attempted in the theater world, with the most recent attempt coming in the Superman musical, It's a Bird, It's a Plane, It's Superman, which premiered 43 years prior, in 1966. And it was easy to see why. It was easier to create the illusion of superhero on the screen, especially with the advancement of special effects technology. In a theater environment, it's close, and the audience can smell anything that doesn't look or feel authentic. To make sure this didn't happen, Taymor applied her spare-no-expense budget, which led the show on a tailspin before casting and rehearsals had even begun. In August of 2009, it soon became evident that the show was millions of dollars short, and there was no choice but to suspend the production until more funds could be raised. This put a hold on ticket sales, marketing, and casting for a show that was promising to open at Foxwoods Theater in just 6 months on February 18th, 2010. This is where Garfinkel's lack of experience and connections really began to show. With Taymor's spare-no-expense mentality, she crafted a script that had the actors fly and fight out over the audience. While this sounded fantastic in theory, it came with an expensive price tag that required a complete overhaul and renovation of the Foxwoods Theater. The theater was designed for straight plays and musicals, not for web-swinging. Using the same technology found in the XFL and NFL for their flying cameras, the harnesses that were connected to the actors would be programmed to a certain track that would in turn fly the actors to where they needed to be at a specific moment or fight scene. This opened the gates to permit hell, as Garfinkel described it. With the theater interior including decorative plaster and ironwork, special permits were required for the renovation, and the protected elements had to be moved and stored in a warehouse. This resulted in an extended construction time and extensive labor that Garfinkel hadn't factored into the budget. With being unable to pay the work crews, production was delayed. As a result of this delay, the company went further into debt, as a big investor who had promised to pay for a good chunk of the renovations backed out the night before sitting down to sign the paperwork. There was also another event that made it even more difficult to secure the funding needed, that event being the Great Recession, which was hitting Broadway's economy hard. There seemed to be one shining light at the end of the tunnel, however, and a savior that came in the form of a mouse.
Economy news, it may be the superhero deal of the decade, and the winner appears to be Disney. The company is spending $4 billion to buy Marvel, getting control of Spider-Man, Iron Man, and the X-Men, among other big-ticket characters in the movies and branding that goes with them.
On August 31st, 2009, Disney made headlines by announcing that they were acquiring Marvel Comics and its properties for a staggering $4.24 billion. The Walt Disney Company, at the time, was valued to be worth around $63.12 billion and possessed the financial backing to pull the show out of its slump and help ensure its Broadway debut. The teaming of Taymor and Disney had proved profitable before, and it could potentially add another hit show to its Broadway catalog. There was just one major problem. Upon the announcement, Disney didn't show any interest in the show, and made no move to assume control or to help the production in its financial straits. In an act of desperation, Garfinkel pulled money from his own company, Hello Entertainment in Chicago, and was able to convince Richard Weinberg and Jeffrey Hechtman to raise their investment in helping the show. The ultimate saving grace came from a deal made with a wealthy family from Texas named the Shermans, who ended up springing for the construction loan to finish renovating the theater and to get the production moving again. While the show appeared to be saved, there was one person who wasn't, and that person was David Garfinkel. The length of the delay, the uncertainty of where the money would be coming from, and the negative press that was starting to surround the show resulted in investors and leaders to lose confidence in Garfinkel as a producer. They viewed him as a novice, who was only in his position because his partner had died. While Garfinkel was attempting to secure funds, Bono was reportedly furious and apparently approached Michael Cole with S2BN Entertainment to take over the production. In November of 2009, Garfinkel was officially ousted and replaced with Cole and Jeremiah J. Harris, the chairman of Live Nation and an investor who was still owed millions for providing staging and scenery. The production did a great job of keeping this buried from the journalists by strategically announcing that they had finally cast their Spider-Man with Reeve Carney. Also in the cast would be Evan Rachel Wood as Mary Jane, and Broadway heavyweight Alan Cumming would be playing the Green Goblin. Cole came into the production full steam ahead and was able to raise a staggering $30 million, which helped to get the show fully capitalized. It still didn't change the fact that the show was hemorrhaging money, and in a few months, the money ran out again. This left Cole with no choice but to cancel the February 2010 opening and attempt to restructure the company. 3 months later, and after a slew of delays, Evan Rachel Wood and Alan Cumming both left the production due to scheduling conflicts, air quotes, when in reality, they both knew that they had to get off this sinking symbiote. The roles were replaced with 19-year-old Jen Damiano, who left her run in Next to Normal as Mary Jane Watson, and Patrick Page of Grinch fame stepping into yet another green-plated costume, this time in the role of the Green Goblin. It's understandable why Cumming and Wood left the production. By the time it started previews, the production's opening date had been delayed two times, with more looking to come down the road. Regardless of the setbacks, and despite the odds, by November 25th, 2010, the first preview occurred. The show went off without a hitch. It remarkably finished under the advertised showtime, and the critics were amazed at the depth of the story and the catchiness of the music. It went on to win 70 Tony Awards and is currently listed in the National Registry as one of the greatest Broadway musicals of all time. I'm sure that's what the producers were hoping would happen. But instead, the first preview was an absolute shit show. The show started 24 minutes after it was slated to begin, And then, the audience didn't even get the full experience because sets were missing entire pieces. In a sequence in which Arachne, the main villain, flies over the audience, a wire malfunction occurred, leaving the actress helpless and embarrassed mid-air over the crowd for 8 minutes. Halfway through Act 1, the stage manager called for a halt over the speakers, in which the audience got to watch as crew members frantically tried to catch Spider-Man by the foot to free him from his harness, which elicited the audience to break out in laughter and ooh, like a tennis match anytime they got close to catching him. Backstage, making her Broadway debut, Natalie Mendoza, who was playing Arachne, was standing off stage when a rope holding a piece of equipment came free and struck her in the head, leaving her with a severe concussion. For unknown reasons, the intermission lasted 40 minutes, and in the last 10 minutes of the show, a final stop occurred, which apparently served as the straw that broke the camel's back for multiple audience members who rose from their seats and exited the theater, with one lady becoming vocal and shouting, "I don't know how everyone else feels, but I feel like a guinea pig today. I feel like it's a dress rehearsal." To which the crowd responded with a chorus of boos. By the end, the preview lasted an hour longer than it had been advertised, and to make matters worse, many reviewers in the city were sick of waiting for an official invitation to the show, and in a radical move, purchased their own tickets for the preview and were met with an utter train wreck. As to be expected, the reviews were not kind. Many called it an epic flop with a dull score and baffling script. The press would become even more negative when the first major injury for the show occurred at a preview on December 20th, 2010.
It looked like it was supposed to be an acrobatic stunt or something, but the person that was playing Spider-Man fell down, like, through the stage floor.
On December 20th, the curtain came up for another preview. The first scene sees Spider-Man jumping off of the Brooklyn Bridge to save Mary Jane Watson, who is dangling precariously with the Green Goblin taunting him the whole time. On this particular night, in front of a live audience, the stunt double for Spider-Man, Chris Tierney, did what he did every night, where he runs and dives off the platform where he was supposed to be caught by his tether and fly. The only difference this time, however, was once Chris jumped, he could tell that he wasn't attached to anything. Tierney plummeted 30 feet off the platform and into the pit, where he broke 4 ribs, fractured his elbow, scapula, and his skull. Remarkably, he survived and was able to return to the production, but not without OSHA fining the producers $12,600 and a slew of negative press appearing after the incident. Soon, the crew and leaders were forced to look at the show, and just like the preview, another series of halts in the production took place. First, from December of 2010 to January of 2011, due to a tremendous amount of creative commotion behind the scenes. Again, from January to February to provide more time for the creators to stage a new final number, make further rewrites to the dialogue, and consider adding and cutting scenes and perhaps adding new music. And again, from February to March to allow Tamor to fine-tune the production and instate a new ending. During all of these pushbacks, previews were still occurring, and it became a case of too much prep time, which was proving to be a hindrance to the show. The final delay came from April 19th to May 11th, 2011. At this point, more than 245,000 people had seen the show over a staggering 140 previews, mainly due to people wanting to see the train wreck in person. With this halt, a total shutdown of the previews occurred. After multiple reworkings, it became agreed upon that the book for the musical was too sloppy and didn't do justice to the Spider-Man story. This is where our friend from American Psycho the Musical, Roberto Aguirre-Sacasa, was brought on board to essentially serve as the metaphorical Joss Whedon to fix this Zack Snyder Justice League. Having had a plethora of experience writing several stories for Spider-Man comics, he reworked the script by changing Arachne, who I'll be getting into the problems with her later, into a supporting character as opposed to the main catalyst for the show, deleting the geek chorus, and keeping the Green Goblin alive past Act 1. The producers were desperate to get Spider-Man to work. Not just for Broadway, however, as they were hoping that if the show became a success, they would be able to transfer the show to Las Vegas and potentially London. What came next was an expensive and bitter game of he said, she said between the producers and the show's next victim, Julie Taymor. The producers, Bono, and The Edge were becoming increasingly upset by the slew of negative reviews and an unwillingness to change on the part of Taymor. According to them, the suggestions they made were ignored, and it soon became evident that Taymor could not objectively reshape the show as ruthlessly as it needed to be. This kicked off what Taymor referred to in court documents as Plan X.
Let me ask you about the situation with Julie Taymor. What would you have done differently to prevent things from turning so ugly?
Holy smokes. Not use Julie Taymor. No, not take the job. In a certain kind of bizarre way, we showed up a lot, but we let Julie have her way. And everybody told us how she behaves the best and creates the best in crisis. And we're sitting there feeling the crisis. But you let Picasso paint.
There's a Broadway producer who puts it this way, that the director is the captain of the ship, but the producer owns the ship.
In secret, a plan was set in motion to rewrite the book, reorder the show, and to avoid the technical challenges that were apparent in the staging of the finale. Allegedly, the company operated behind closed doors, holding a series of discussions and meetings without Taymor's knowledge, agreeing to operate on a twin track, in which Taymor was allowed to pursue her own efforts as they secretly worked to get Taymor off the show. Whether or not Plan X was real, after 9 years of work on Spider-Man, Taymor left the production, and Philip William McKinley, who was known for his work with the Ringley Bros and Barnum and Bailey Circus, was brought on board to direct. Through this delay of April to May, McKinley and Aguirre Sacasa worked feverishly to implement changes, but Taymor wouldn't go quietly. In court proceedings, Taymor felt that there were over 30 pages of false, misleading allegations aimed at blaming her for the problems encountered in the development of the musical. The lawsuit was ultimately settled out of court in April 2013, in which Taymor insisted $36,000 in royalty due to it still being essentially her script, and a director's fee of $125,000. All of the court proceedings only added to the negative perception of the show.
Finally, one of the biggest financial bets or busts in the history of theater is taking form as a musical about the comic book hero Spider-Man. After months of expense and controversy, it's finally scheduled to open on Broadway tonight.
Finally, after the nearly 9-year process, 6 delays, 5 injuries, 1 death of a producer, revolving door of changing show leaders, 1 court proceeding, and 182 previews, Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark premiered on Broadway on June 14th, 2011. Over 1 year and 4 months after the first opening night date was announced. Many critics agreed that the reworked show was clearer and that Aguirre Sacasa was able to inject a fanboy humor and even a self-conscious acknowledgement to the rocky gestation of the production. But that didn't mean that they liked it. The Hollywood Reporter called it a bloated monster, and the New York Times branded it a bore, but still gave favorable reviews to all the performers. If reviews stand for anything, this surely meant the death of the show, and that it wouldn't be able to even last 4 months. And yet, something incredible happened. Despite the negative reviews and bad publicity, Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark was still able to consistently sell out the 1,928-seat Foxwoods Theater. In the first year and a half of the show, they had brought in over $1.5 million, and on the week ending January 1st, 2012, it set a new single-week Broadway gross, earning $2.9 million. The show was thriving because it piqued the curiosity of the audience. Word of mouth had traveled far and wide that many people had to see what all the hubbub was about. Much like the overwhelming success of cult movies like The Room, people wanted to see if the show was as garbage and meme-worthy as it appeared. The show ran for more than 1,000 performances. In September of 2013, Reeve Carney handed off the lead to Justin Matthew Sargent. 2 months later, the initial curiosity for the show had waned, and ticket sales began to drop. Add in the producers were no longer able to get injury insurance, and in November of 2013, it was announced that Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark would officially close on January 4th, 2014. On paper, looking at the sales and attendance, it seemed like Spider-Man was a hit. But in the end, after 3 years, the largest show in Broadway history had cost investors $60 million. It went down in history as the biggest money loser and worst reviewed show on Broadway.
I've never read quite so horrific reviews. Things like the New York Times, it may rank among the worst musicals ever made. The Washington Post, shrill, insipid mess. What did you guys think when you read these?
It's the sort of stuff we were saying backstage. I mean, seriously, might have been a little hard for some other people around here to take that. But we don't disagree with the New York Times.
So how do you narrow down exactly what went wrong with this show and why it failed? The first main point, and the biggest one, is that the show was simply too expensive to run. Historically, only a quarter of Broadway shows are ever able to recoup their production costs and to possibly turn a profit. The show ended with a $79 million price tag, the largest in Broadway history, with the next highest being Shrek the Musical, which came in with an overall budget of $27.6 million. That's a difference of nearly $22 million. To put that into perspective, the entire budget of Hamilton was only $12.5 million. Some of what made up that $79 million came from $1 million to the show lawyers, $6 million towards paying the stagehands, and $8 million towards their construction loan. The extended preview span also cost the company a large amount of money, coming in at a staggering 182 previews. This was damaging to the show because it was costing $100,000 a week to rent the Foxwoods Theater. The delays that came from the renovation of said theater also cost the company an estimated $2 million for the harnesses, flying rigs, and refined logistics, on top of $4 million to rent the theater for the 2 years before performances began, whereas most productions rent the theater for a few months at the most before opening. Then there was the $200,000 in the Taymor settlement to factor in, and it was estimated that the show would have had to continue selling out for 7 years to recoup the costs. At the beginning, the show appeared to be performing incredible, box office-wise, but that doesn't get very far when factoring in that the cost of running the show was $1 million a week. Looking at the simple checks and balances, there was no possible way that the show could financially afford to run once initial interest in the show wore off. When asked in an interview, Michael Cole said that if he had been with the show from the start, he would have made a budget that was 30% less than what it was. This could have come from toning down the technical requirements of the show. Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark was an ambitious endeavor because, in a sense, it had to attempt to be like the movies. But where the Raimi films had the added freedom of a studio budget of $139 million and the ability to use camera tricks and special effects to bring Spider-Man to life, Turn Off the Dark had to do it in a practical setting, with real human beings swinging around, as opposed to a fake mannequin that Kirsten Dunst could hold on to. Another thing is that a theater isn't designed to run like a circus or arena show. The production in the Foxwoods before Spider-Man was Young Frankenstein, to put into perspective the types of shows that the theater was used to. Look at Cirque du Soleil shows like Ka, Mystère, or Beatles Love. They all include intense acrobatics and fly systems much like what Spider-Man was going for. The difference is that in Las Vegas, their theaters were built with the purpose of acrobatics and fly systems in mind. The Foxwoods is a combination of the Apollo and Lyric theaters, which were built in 1920 and 1903, respectively. The only fly systems they had in mind when constructing those theaters were the possible witches still hiding among us. It makes me think that if the goal for producers was to end up in Las Vegas or London, why did they feel they needed to go to Broadway? Why couldn't they make a touring company, or do arena shows much like Marvel Live currently does, and get the word out about the show that way? It would have been cheaper, I'm sure. But they had to bring the movies to Broadway. It's amazing to me because it was originally going to cost even more to run the show with a $1 million spider web hanging over the audience in a battle sequence. However, the web kept catching on things, and in the end, they cut it out. By making the show too technologically advanced, it also opened the doors to having to combat lawsuits and injuries as well. I also feel that it was in this over-dependence and reliance on the technological aspect of the show that they forgot the most important element of what makes theater theater, and why people go to Broadway. And that is a good, compelling story. A story that wasn't present, for the simple fact that the show got tame-ored.
I've been like a father to you. Be a son to me now.
I have a father. His name was Ben Parker.
Godspeed, Spider-Man.
Pretty much everyone knows the story of Spider-Man, especially in 2010 when previews had started. We had had the entire Raimi trilogy up to that point, and multiple video games and TV shows as well. Young kid happens to be in the right spot at the right time, gets bitten by a spider, becomes Spider-Man. Now let me walk you through how it happens in Turn Off the Dark, in which Tamor, and Berger to an extent, essentially rewrite the entire origin to a way that robs the story of what makes Spider-Man special. In the show, it plays out a lot like the Raimi movies and the comics, where Peter is on a field trip to Oscorp when a spider is revealed to be out on the loose and soon it bites him. That's as simple as it needed to be. But Tamor was obsessed with running with the idea of Greek mythology, and how in a sense, our superheroes are modern-day Greek gods and demigods. This is evident by her creation of a character named Arachne. No relation to Julia Carpenter's Spider-Woman in the comics, this is a new character, that is, the literal Greek goddess. It's an interesting concept, I have to admit, but it gets carried away when it comes to light that Arachne is the reason that Peter Parker became Spider-Man. He was destined to become it. She made his costume, and she made the mutant spider bite him. Why? I can't tell you. Maybe because the show opens with Peter giving a report on Arachne and has a total hard-on for spiders? This is the first problem with the script. I'm all for updating and reimagining, but in having Arachne target Peter, it robs the Spider-Man character of the main point that helps the audience relate and root for him. Audiences like to get behind the idea that anyone can be a superhero, even a scrawny nerd from Queens. It's the idea that the spider could have bit anyone that makes Peter Parker special, not that he did an oral report on a Greek goddess. Then, if that wasn't enough, they go one step further and effectively remove one of the most compelling first storylines in which Peter assumes his role as a protector and in using his powers for good. It's in the comics and the movies where after getting screwed over by someone, he lets a bad guy get away who then in turn shoots his Uncle Ben. Peter holds him in his arms, and soon he sees that his consequences have actions, and that he can be the difference. He can help keep others from having the traumatic event that he has in seeing his uncle get killed. This is all built up by establishing a strong relationship between Peter and Uncle Ben, in which you can feel that Uncle Ben is an important person to him and can effectively serve as a guiding light through his life. It also adds to the dramatic narrative that while Peter was at the right place at the right time for the spider bite, Uncle Ben was in the wrong place at the wrong time for the carjacking. Just as a spider could have bit anybody, the carjacker could have stolen any car. It just happened to be Uncle Ben's. The musical, on the other hand, gives us one two-minute scene with Uncle Ben. Peter beats Bonesaw at the wrestling event. Then, on his way home, Flash Thompson goes into MJ's house. Then a dude steals Flash's car, so Uncle Ben decides to run after him for some reason. And then the carjacker runs him over. And then Peter goes to his room, and Arachne shows up, says, "Hey, I feel for you, bro. Here's a costume I made you." And then all of a sudden, Spider-Man swings through the city like, "Oh, all right. Sucks that he died, but hey, I got a costume now." So, that's dope. It felt like the first version of the show was too focused on showing Tamor through the art, as opposed to Tamor helping to elevate the dramatic narrative that is already established. It felt like there were two plays of Tamor's Greek epic Spider-Man mixed in with the beats from the movie that people had come to expect. This is best evident by the inclusion of a literal Greek chorus, which was in turn called a geek chorus, that was unnecessary and seemed to rob the show of an actual compelling narrative. It was confusing because as the play was going on, they were writing the story. So it became a show within a show, in a sense, and created a narrative that wasn't necessary. We don't need people commenting on a Spider-Man story. Just let the narrative play out. Imagine if, in Avengers Infinity War, after they get rid of Vision, a group of people come out and say, "Well, looks like Thanos is defeated," and then another person says, "That's what you think, but wait, I think there's still more. Let's have him turn back time." It wouldn't make sense. But in essence, that's what happens in Act 2. Spider-Man kills Green Goblin at the end of Act 1 by getting him caught in a piano that goes over the edge of the bridge and kills him? Because Berger really wanted to drop a piano on George Bush when he was writing this play? That was the reason it was in there? Anyways, Act 2 starts. The geek chorus comes out and says, "Well, his ultimate enemy is defeated." And then the teacher's like, "Nah, I don't think so, because Spider-Man's ultimate enemy should be unbeatable. So here's the Sinister Six." And the Sinister Six on stage sounds awesome in theory. But then you look at the way the characters aren't introduced with any backstory besides they're evil, and that Taimor cut out Mysterio, Doc Ock, and the Vulture, who actually has a reason to fly, and instead brings in her own character that the teacher creates called Swiss Miss, who is basically a walking pocket knife named after hot chocolate. It doesn't make sense! And the last thing we see in Act 1 is Spider-Man kissing Mary Jane and proudly saying, "I'm your friendly neighborhood Spider-Man." Then, all of a sudden in Act 2, for no reason, besides he's tired, he's given up being Spider-Man, and instead just lets the villains run around because he basically wants to get laid by MJ. The city is literally being destroyed, and he doesn't give a shit. When the last time you saw him, he was proudly saying, "I'm Spider-Man." Imagine you come back from intermission, expecting him to do Spider-Man stuff, because you've spent the entire first act seeing him become the hero, and it ends with him now officially being the Spider-Man we all know, but instead, he's just all of a sudden given up. There's no context or reasoning to it. In the films and in the comics, it took time for him to stop being Spider-Man. It was a narrative. In the movies, it's not until halfway through Spider-Man 2 that he gives up being Spider-Man. And you get to see why, because you've been following the characters for a movie and a half. Here, there's no reason. So anyway, he abandons the suit just like Spider-Man 2, and then Arachne arrives to Peter in a dream and convinces him to be Spider-Man again. That simple. Some of the most beautiful series of scenes in the Raimi films, in which Uncle Ben is the catalyst for helping him pick up the mantle again, are substituted for a mystic goddess whom Peter has never met. There's no personal connection or personal stakes added to it, and in essence, it robs the story of its human core. And that's the best way I can sum up Taimor's version of Spider-Man. It sacrifices the human elements for a few cool web-swinging tricks and spectacle. The death of the Green Goblin is one of the major points of Spider-Man and Peter Parker's character arc. The night Gwen Stacy died was one of the most controversial and shocking comic publications of its time, because that wasn't something you do in comic book stories. You don't kill off the love interest. And yet still, after Peter loses that person that he cared about most in the world, he can't bring himself to kill the Goblin, leaving the Goblin to meet a poetic ending by being killed by his own glider. There's weight to it. It means something. Now, like I said before, it's important with material that's been around for a while to update and reimagine, but you can't forget the core of the story you're updating. Christopher Nolan did a great job of this with the Batman trilogy, where he successfully updated the character while still staying true to the roots of the origin and what makes Batman, Batman. His parents were killed in a mugging in an alleyway. not because they came out of the theater, a man grabbed a random lady's purse, and then the parents felt the need to chase the mugger. I don't want this to sound like I hate Julie Taymor. I don't. The thing I've noticed with her, however, is that she is better at being a visual scene setter than a storyteller. The set design is absolutely breathtaking, and aesthetically, the show is beautiful and out of the box. What I don't like is that it feels like Taymor was more concerned with making people know that this was her Spider-Man, as opposed to elevating and building off the Spider-Man that countless artists and writers had contributed to for over 50 years. She threw the legacy out the window and was soon devoured by her own sense of hubris. Countless producers felt that she wouldn't work with others and allegedly refused to develop a musical that followed the original Spider-Man story. She even went so far as actively inserting herself into the story in the form of Arachne. She was the one giving creation and pulling the strings for Spider-Man's new life. She wanted to show that comic books were a part of a larger mythos that had been around since before the Greeks, and she took from the Greek myths just like Shakespeare had done, as well as from the origin of the spider. In doing this, it robbed Spider-Man of his soul and delivered someone that audiences couldn't recognize and gave little reason to care about him. This all could have been avoided if early on Garfinkel had been better at putting his foot down with Taymor. While it's well known in the industry that Taymor isn't exactly easy to work with, it is also known that Taymor performs best when she is under supervision. This was what made Lion King such a success. Disney took tack with her and some of her decisions, a tack that Garfinkel couldn't deliver. Taymor was given too much free rein, which couldn't have been fair to her either, because all of a sudden, the full creative weight of the show was placed on her shoulders, especially from, you guessed it, Bono. Bono had never attempted composing a show, and he figured that he could figure it out as he went along and learn at Julie's side. This was apparent by the show failing to create any catchy, easy-to-digest pop songs. Much like American Psycho, no one was leaving the theater whistling a catchy song, and most of the crew agreed with the feeling that the music was lifeless. Where composers like Danny Elfman were able to capture the excitement, beauty, and tragedy of the Spider-Man story, Turn Off the Dark's music felt less like a Spider-Man musical, and instead it felt like a tame U2 concert that was created because they were there for a paycheck and to stick it to Andrew Lloyd Webber. Bono and the Edge would go on to say that they felt the reason their music lacked any life was because they lacked a creative, strong producer in Garfinkel early on. While this may have been true, it also became evident that Spider-Man wasn't a top priority for them either. In one email Taymor sent, she practically begged them to attend rehearsals, saying, "I have been at Spider-Man nonstop. We need you. It is not easy to change anything, but now I think it is a matter of lyrical and musical changes." Taymor even wanted to close the production in December of 2010 or January of 2011, but was told no by producers because Bono and The Edge weren't around. And this ties into a bigger problem and another reason the show didn't succeed, that being a huge breakdown of communication. This is especially evident by the he said, she said nature of Taymor's departure, in which one party felt one way while the other felt a different way. It feels like there was a lack of collaboration and compromise behind the scenes that was perhaps fueled by an inflated sense of hubris amongst everyone on the production. Everyone felt that, sure, it might look bad now, but in the end, it's going to look great. This was a feeling that everyone carried with them for 3 years, right up until closing. It's remarkable because they had such a strong feeling that the show was going to be great that they only held one workshop for the show before launching into a 7-month preview period. Then, with the previews, Taymor wouldn't change the script because so much kept going wrong and she just wanted to wait until everything went right. The same feeling was felt with Bono, who in a 2011 interview directly stated his hubris by saying, "We have a lot to learn. We were way out of our depth. And that's, I suppose, the hubris we deserve." They believed that the show was going to be incredible, and that the show they currently had was great. It was just being hindered by technical difficulties. So they were reluctant to make any changes. The reviewers, and especially Twitter, which was coming into its own during this time, begged to differ. The previews became a Twitter phenomenon, with people attending them, live-tweeting their experience and what a train wreck was unfolding before their eyes. The bad publicity surrounding the production didn't help either, especially with the behind-the-scenes turmoil between Garfinkel, Cole, Taymor, and Bono circulating in the tabloids. In a 2011 interview with The Guardian, Alan Cumming, the original Green Goblin, was quoted as saying, "My God, that was a lucky escape. Talk about dodging a bullet there." While in the beginning, the negative publicity played a huge role in drumming up public curiosity, once that started to fade away, they were still stuck with a show that wasn't that good, and hence wasn't sustainable. Regardless of how it played out, Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark was still a monumental feat in Broadway history. It did the impossible of bringing the web swinger to the medium of live theater, and pushed what really was possible in a Broadway show from a technical standpoint. It also carved its own place in pop culture, if anything, as a way of making fun of the disaster that surrounded the show with multiple skits on SNL, Robot Chicken, and Conan O'Brien. If Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark is remembered for anything, it will be remembered for being the most ambitious flop on Broadway. Of course, what makes it more bittersweet was that everyone on the cast and crew truly wanted it to be good. And they believed that what they were working on in the core was revolutionary. It was this sense of hubris that doomed the production by eliminating the collaboration and tweaking needed to make the show truly amazing.